everyone, Pastor BJ here, coming to you from Kirkmont Church. For those of you that have been in church for any length of time, one of the things that you will notice is that at every single worship service you attend, it's very, very likely to have included music. In fact, I would almost challenge you to think of a time you've been in a worship service where singing a song of praise and worship did not occur. And the reason for that is because singing praise during our Lord's Day worship service is one of the most important things we do as Christians. And oftentimes this is something that's sort of just assumed rather than actually thought about deeply. So for this week and the next couple of weeks, I have asked our brother Daniel Galey, the worship leader here at Kirkmont, to join us for a discussion about worship. How's it going, Daniel?
It's going very well. Thank you.
Now, for those of you that may not know, Daniel, not only is he our worship leader here at Kirkmont, he's also working with our youth. But this guy has a very solid background in theological and musical training. He's got a degree at Cedarville University in music, and he is currently in seminary at Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary. And so this guy's brain is full of worship and theological knowledge. So, well, Daniel, I hope I introduced you well there.
Yeah, probably.
All right, well, let's go ahead and dig in here. So, Daniel, since singing is involved in every single worship service we do, why is music and singing so important to corporate worship?
Yeah, I think the most basic answer to that question, why is singing and why is music important to corporate worship, is because God commands us to do it. One passage from Ephesians 5, verses 18 through 20, which says this: "Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." Another passage is Colossians chapter 3, verse 16, which says, "Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts." So we see this aspect where our songs are geared towards others, this horizontal, towards ourselves and towards others. And a few of those I want to sort of unpack a little bit. One of those from Colossians specifically says that we teach others through songs. And it's this idea of where, like, for example, those who may be struggling to believe in God's power, we sing songs like Waymaker or There's Nothing That Our God Can't Do. And this encourages others to trust God, to believe in him, and that he truly is able to do anything, that he truly does accomplish miracles and work in and through our lives. It's teaching one another that God is a powerful and all-powerful God. Furthermore, our singing songs to one another can admonish ourselves, and we can admonish other people with it as well. One song that I think of in that regard is the song Graves into Gardens. I love that song, and the chorus is very simple, yet I think very profound, and the first line of that says, "There's nothing better than you." And it's a very simple line, and if I asked anybody, like, "Do you believe that?" they may be like, "Well, sure, yeah, of course, there's nothing better than God." And yet when we really begin to think about what that looks like in our own lives, and we begin to evaluate, is there something that I may be holding higher than God? Or is there maybe something that I'm viewing as better than God? I think many times we'll realize that we may believe that, and we may say that it's true, but we don't always live it out in that way. And so we can see these warnings. We can see this conviction as we sing songs to one another, that when we sing this line, "There's nothing better than you," somebody could be struggling with this idea of having other idols in their lives. And we sing this song and we sing this line, and they may be convicted and realize, yes, that's true, that's right. And I need to stop, you know, holding these other things to such a high esteem. And I need to realize and recognize that there is nothing better than God. As a result, he is worthy of all of my worship and all of my praise. And another aspect that a benefit from singing corporately is that when we sing together as the body of Christ, it is a very unifying aspect. And I can't overemphasize this, but the songs that we sing should be based on scripture. And Colossians, that the passage out of Colossians 3 clearly lays that out when it starts, like the where we start from singing songs and teaching one another is by letting the message of Christ dwell in us richly. We are able to teach and admonish one another through psalms and hymns and spiritual songs and all these different ways. But it starts with a foundation of God's word inside of us. So if that is the case, if these songs are based on the scripture, and here we are as one body raising truth and praise together, it is a very unifying aspect as we recognize and align our wills and our lives to these truths that we are singing. We're singing to one another to encourage them, to teach them about who God is, about what he has done, to trust him when we are tempted to doubt, to believe that he is powerful and able to do the things that he says he's going to do, and even to convict us of sins that we may have committed. And it's a very unifying thing. As a result, I mean, there are great benefits to corporate worship that we can see in scripture.